Okay, I want to give you an overview of the status of the present Swiss Fell. I want to make more or less an explanation of where are we, what are we building, mostly the experimental stations, the infrastructure we are building on, the different phases of Swiss Fell, and at the end comes something that is important for you about access and when are we ready or what are we aiming for. Okay, just in a nutshell, Swiss Fell will have two branches called Aramis for the hard X-ray part, Altos for the soft X-ray part. And if you know literature, you know that there are two other musketeers. That means we have still room of improvement for Portos and for D'Artagnan. At the moment, at the present, we are building the hard X-ray part, the Aramis beam line, going from 2 kV to around 15 kV in photon energy. The pulse duration, depending on the charge you have, from 5 to 100 femtoseconds, for which half maximum. In this case, the polarization is completely linear. If you want to use transcircular polarized and hard X-rays, you have to have it just optically to change the phase of the polarization. And at the moment, we are just building on SASA. It's just a noise converting machine. But we are still thinking on the self scene, the same schemes as the present situation of LCLS one. It is a 100 Hz repetition machine, normal conducting. In the case of Atos, I will present something later on, it's just a soft X-ray part from 250 eV going up to 1.9 kV, covering from the carbon edge up to the silicon edge and matching well just the extension from Atos to Aramis. And the lower 250 eV is because there are already a lot of high harmonic generation sources that are coming from the lower energy going up to 200 eV. And there's a good overlap with that. We don't want to compete on a very, very low energy. And there is also the Fermi free electron accelerator in Trieste that is doing extremely well and flash at these very low energies. In the case of Atos, the pulse duration could be in the same order of magnitude, even sometimes better. We are planning to make the undulators in a way that you can produce circular polarized light or elliptical polarized light, and you can change the polarization in the direction that you want. That's very important in the soft X-ray part to see all the properties of the transition method. I will come later to this operation, the so-called CHIC. I will explain that later what that is. Still 100 Hz repetition rate, but in view of the discussions with users that would like to have a higher repetition at lower charges, we are also thinking to do somehow of special burst mode for Atos, similar to the one that is done at the European XFEL, not in the same repetition rate as LCLS2, but we are in principle capable to do this type of burst mode. Now, the things that we are building at the moment are very much based on the pattern, the strength of the view of the scientific strength of the groups in Switzerland. And we are concentrating the first one in time-resolved chemistry, time-resolved solid state dynamics, and then remembering protein structure or especially serial protein crystallography. And in the first station, we are especially dedicated a lot of photochemistry and photobiology. And later on, due to new developments, we are trying to go into nonlinear X-ray optics. Okay, that is more or less, if you want to make just a plot of the different modes, operation modes that we can have. With Aramis, is the normal 200 picocoulomb mode where you have the highest pulse energy, 1 millijoule, something around the factor of 3 to 5 lower the LCLS1. That has to do with the energy. We have only 6 GeV and the LCLS is higher energy. The typical spectral width, 0.1% RMS, path lengths of 20 femtoseconds. We can have, if you lower the charge just to 10 picoseconds, you just have a much better timing resolution at the price paid by a lower pulse energy. But we can chart the beam in a way that you can have also a large bandwidth, something between 3 to 8%. That you can have just coming out of your beam that can be have a very good use either for Raman crystallography or for two colors for different things. That's something that we can do because of the compactness of the Swiss fab. And there are ideas in the future if you can lower just the charge more that we can produce somehow sub femtosecond beams coming out from Aramis. That is, once we have investigated and we know how the machine is running, we can also, at lower pulse energy, we can have 0.2 femtosecond beams, X-ray beams. Now, where are we located? That's just a picture of the whole PSI, the PSI West, the PSI East, with the river Aare in between. On that part, we are concentrating the normal large-scale facilities, the proton accelerator with the neutron spallation source, the muon spallation source, the Swiss light source that you know very well. And on the other side of the river, we have the Swiss fell, 750 meters long. It's the only part near PSI where we can find a flat ground in order to build this type of machine. The very good thing is not only the two facilities that we have nearby, we have a bunch of laboratories here nearby, the bio laboratory head by Gertrud Schertler, where there are the possibility to have all the preparation labs. We have the injector test set up. We have electron microscopes, a lot of biology and chemistry on this part. And on the other side of the river, we have the protein crystallography beam lines at the SLS. We have the crystallization facility. And in the future, in 5 years from now, there will be here a so-called innovation park, where a lot of companies should be there in order to gain from the capabilities we have at PSI. One of the difficulties of building Swissfell in the woods is that you have to convince the people to give you a big piece of land, and you know how precious the woods are in Switzerland. And you go just to the community and say, please give me as much as that. I want to build a new facility just on top. And then you have all the hunters, the joggers, the F, and all the people say, oh no, you cannot do that, it's very difficult. Well, we see we have done all the work. You have here the facility that's just completely finished. The injector part is here, the accelerator, undulator hall, and the experimental hall at the very end. We can have a lot of ancillary equipment nearby. We have to rely on the things that we have on the PSI side, but we have to be sure that we can build these natural bridges for deers and for other animals, because by law you cannot build in the forest 700 meters something that blocks you the transportation or the pathway to the park. We have spent a lot of money for that, and we have the first users. In the night, the first deers were crossing past these things. That means, from the point of view of the ecology, Swissfell is already a great success. Yes, it's finished. We can say to the politicians, we have done it. Okay. Okay, we are just very far away. You have seen just the outside part. 80% of the accelerator is already into the tunnel. We have the in vacuum undulators in order to produce the hard X-ray part. Undulators built all in Switzerland. That's the first one installed inside. We already have 7 in place in the tunnel and the total of 12. That means by middle of this year, in September, we will have all the undulators in place. You don't see the big picture, but here is all the part with the front end and going into the optics. That's already all done. We were forced to build the tunnel really in a very, very short dimension. That means we have to transport all the things that we have with air cushion vehicles, and we have to spend a lot of money in order to have a very clean, very flat floor in order to make all these transportations. That was one of the biggest headaches we had there. Okay. Most interesting part for you are probably the experimental station. That's just a 3D drawing of the experimental hall. I have said we will have 2 branches, one for the soft X-rays, the other for the hard X-rays, and the accelerator part of the soft X-rays are shorter than for the longer X-rays. That means we can place the experimental hall for the soft X-rays prior to the for the hard X-rays. We can make a very long experimental hall and small in transfer dimensions. A big experimental hall for the soft X-ray part, where in the future we can have up to 3 instruments, something around 700 square meter space for the soft X-ray part. And for the hard X-ray part, 3 separate hatches of the same order of magnitude as the ones at LCLS. We are not very good in making new names, and our experimental stations are called the presentation A, B, C, D, E, F. And you see experimental station A, B, and experimental station C, and then we come the others. A lot of auxiliary equipment. We have the control rooms, a preparatory lab, a mechanical lab, just the entrance, chemical labs here, a dark room for chemistry, IT services, and all that. That's what we have just inside the experimental hall. Now, just coming specially to the hard X-ray lines, we will have just the X-rays coming from the Aramis undulators will be divided with these offset mirrors just going into experimental station A, or the direct beam to the experimental station B, and in the future to the third experimental station. That means, as in the other facilities, you can have either one or another facility running. We are not planning at the moment, but we have the space reservation to do the same schemes at the LCLS just by dividing the beam and having a diffracted beam for one experimental station and the normal one. The space is there, but at the moment we start just either the first, the second, or in the future the third one. Well, one of the important things is all the photon diagnostics you need in order to see how your X-ray beam is coming out. We are using the gas beam position intensity monitor that was developed at TESI. They have built all these devices for us, are already installed in the tunnel and work very well. The position monitor for hard X-rays, work done at SACLA that we are taking over, and the only thing that we are developing is the high resolution signal shot spectrometer to determine that shot by shot the spectral distribution of the X-rays, and the photo arrival monitor based on a terahertz trig camera. And that's just the single shot spectrometer coming out from the ideas developed at LCLS with the bent crystals. Christian David had the idea to introduce the focusing diamond diffraction grating. We have tested that also at the LCLS, and now it's just a combination of these 2 ideas that is put just in one in order to have a very high transmission X-rays for the experimental station and a very high efficient way of making determination of the spectral distribution of the X-rays. Now, the 3 hard X-ray experimental stations, as I say, The first one, ASA, dedicated to ultrafast photochemistry and photobiology. The second one, PAM-PAM probe diffraction solid state dynamics. If you want, is somehow a separation of XPP dedicated special to the two different things. Dedicated very much either to spectroscopy and photobiology, or dedicated more to solid state hard X-ray dynamics. And in the future, in the third station that will come probably in 2 years from now, we want to develop a submicron beam, especially for material sciences, for nanocrystallography, also for CDI experiments, or for nonlinear optics. As I said, these two beam lines should be ready, the experimental station should be ready by middle of the next year. And all that is put in just in the scientific case written by or edited by Bruce Patterson already 3 to 4 years ago. So you still can look what was behind all these experimental stations. Now, coming especially for the experimental station A, that is important for the biology. In the experimental stations, we are building two different experimental chambers. One very, really dedicated, especially for chemistry and photobiology, and the second one, more or less a flexible general purpose station in the second part. This one is very close to the focusing optics, allowing us to have something around 1 micron beam spot, especially good for serial protein crystallography. But we are extending all the beam line also to use this 10-dot X-ray range going up from 2 to 5 keV, something that is not the normal way of, not the present situation, neither at LCLS nor in SACLA. All the beam lines there started at higher energies. Now, the idea is really, with this beam line and with this experimental station, what we call prime, is to really get a holistic picture of one sample. That means we are applying a lot of different methods, either the X-ray emission spectrometers that we are building in, or inelastic X-ray scattering in the forward direction, or the high energy resolution of resonance spectroscopy, so that you can have all spectroscopic methods just in once applied to your sample. And we are developing for that just the von Hammer's geometry, so that we can have shot by shot the highest information from the emission spectrometer of your sample. And on the other side, for the serial protein crystallography, we are making the chamber in a special situation so that we can put a Jungfrau detector as close as possible to the sample position, something around 10 centimeters away, so that you have a very range of distances, of X-ray energy, and of possible resolution you can achieve if your sample is a very good one. The detector is in this configuration completely in air, so that you can move the detector back and forth. And you can use the detector also completely in combination with all the spectroscopical methods we have here on the side. And this vacuum chamber can work either in air or the neutral atmosphere, or even go up to vacuum conditions, depending of the type of experiments you want to perform. That's just a 3D drawing of this chamber, divided in three parts. In the first part, you have all the beam conditioning optics, collimators, also the entrance for the optical beam coming here from the side. You have the position for the sample injection, different sample injectors. It can be the LCP injector that we bought from ASU, or liquid injectors for chemistry. And on this side, you have the chamber dedicated to the spectroscopy measurements with this strip 2D detector and the foam multicrystal von Hammer spectrometer on that side. And on the back, you see the detector. I will come later to the explanation of
of the detector.
Now you see here, we, people have to make a lot of considerations of how the geometry should be put in, where should be the hole that you need for the detector, in which direction should it be put. And that's just the second position of the detector in place, already installed. As I already said, we have the injector system from ASU that we have put in place. We have already in a lab, just a preparation lab, in order to check the different type of samples we want to put in. We have used that that injector already at the SLS just to do serial protein crystallography, just at synchrotrons, and the technician is working already all the time in order to improve that part, and we are thinking the way of produce ourselves the most important parts in the middle, the capillaries that we have to do, we have to learn all that. I think we are now already prepared with the injector to use that at least at the very beginning, the first years, either at the Swiss light source or at the Swiss fell. The other second experimental station that we have is just this one. It's completely a flexible detector where you can have any type of movements. You have the sample here in the middle, you have the von Hammer's spectrometer here, you have the detector, and depending of the cool range you want to see or what you want to have, you can completely change and look at the different positions for all the places. That's just a perfect detector where you don't know what exactly to do. You have all the flexibility in air. That's already working. It is already used at the SLS. And it's a very good thing. One of the developments that we have made here is to produce very good crystals, analyzer crystals, in order to have a big curvature, a very big solid angle. The distance between the sample and these crystals are only 25 centimeters. Normally you are using 50 centimeters or 1 meter. That means the good thing is you have a very good resolution, a very big solid angle. That means you can have a emission spectrometer shot by shot with enough intensity to do all the experiments. Okay, I hope you are convinced and you will use this experimental station in the future also at Swiss Fell. The second one is more or less ASP dedicated to pump and probe experiments in solid state physics. Here we are building also two experimental chambers, but having more or less on the same position, so that the beam that is here of the order of 2 to 3 microns is of the same size either for this 6-circle diffractometer or for any other type of user experiments, and we can just move this one to the side and put the second one in place. The detector, also 16M detector, we can later to that, is just on a big robot on the ceiling, and you can have in air all the different positions of your detector for diffraction geometry. You have the biggest flexibility with this detector, either with the diffractometer or with this heavy load experimental station. I have discussed with some people that we are also developing a fixed target serial crystallography for the experimental station B, where we can have just a vacuum chamber that can be used, just a normal vacuum chamber with controlled humidity, or in vacuum or with helium. We are bringing just the samples inside, the possibility to have also some cryojet if necessary. And the idea is to have just these plates, as explained this morning, where we can transport with 100 Hertz, with a very high precision, something around sub-microns, the fixed target to the position where the crystals are. The idea is just to have the crystals, to pre-locate them, we don't exactly know how to do it, and then to move these plates just with 100 Hertz and very high precision into the beam. There are the different parts, just either
we still have to work on the prelocation. We have to bring the beam just into the sample, just at the position of the detector. And at the end, the people think that they need also a cryopooled repository and just the robots that are bringing the samples into the beam position, if that's necessary. This unit will be used by 2018 at the ASP station, and in the future, when we have the third station with a submicron beam, we will transport this experiment station to the third one. Now, other developments that are very important, I want just to bring two of them. I made just a short introduction to the beam diagnostics. The second one is also the sources of pump radiation. We have the normal optical lasers as all the other peoples have, and we are trying to develop now also laser-based terahertz sources, either in the direction of having a very broadband terahertz radiation, as it's the case here, or to have a terahertz radiation with small bandwidth, something around 1 or 2%, all that based on lasers and not on an accelerator scheme. And the new idea is to use the developments made in the Russian Academy of Science with this phosphorite pump laser that you can develop and you can buy. And that's one of the measurements we did together with them in Moscow, just with a more or less a single cycle pulse that produce you terahertz radiation from 1 to 5 terahertz. It will be very nice to extend that to 6 or 7 terahertz, especially for biological samples, or the other way around, that we are testing that, making the pulse in the time very broad so that you can have 1 or 2% delta E over E with the terahertz radiation. I think that's a very important development. It will be certainly used to make a selective pumping of phonon modes, either in material science, it could be also very good in biology. I think that is a development that, that we have to certainly to continue. And the other idea that we are developing very much is the Jungfrau detector. It's a development that was at the very beginning common with the AGIP detector for the European X-FEL. And we have used part of this this development that we made together with Egypt to build our own detector that has some differences, very good differences to the Egypt detector. The first one is being a detector for 100 hertz or even going up to 1 kilohertz. We don't need to store the images into the chip as the Egypt detector are forced to do. That means we can lower or shrink the pixel size more or less by a factor of 10. The detectors at the European X-FEL have 200 by 200 pixel sizes, and we have 75 by 75 micron pixel sizes. And you can build that in a modular way, just starting with just one module, 500 kilopixels, and adding that going to 1 mega, 4 mega, 16 megapixels in the detector. Now, the limitation at the moment for these detectors are not only the price, but also the weight to take out the data from the detector. Because you need for every single of these modules more or less an independent strain that at the end you will have. If you have a 16M or as people are thinking of 32M, you have at least 10, 12, 20 parallel lines going out into your server room. And that is at the moment probably the limitation, the physical limitation we will have in the size for the detectors. The detector, the single module is working very well. To hear us, people always love to take these pictures of the absorption of flowers. A very low noise level, I will come to that. Highly reproducibility, and now we are in the way of producing all these modules. The very good thing of this Jungfrau is that you have a noise peak that is really, really very low. And we can detect X-rays as low as 1.75 kV, just having really a separation between the noise peak and your detector. But this is an ideal detector also to go in to the lower part, for instance, if you want to do single particle imaging at 2 kV, the things that the people in Uppsala are thinking of, you can use really this type of detector. And it has also a relatively good energy selectivity. You see here in the case of kappa, you can detect easily kappa alpha from kappa beta, 900 eV separation. You can really see the two peaks very good. Because this detector will be very much used also as a low detector. It's very important that, because we are using that technology also for the ASA station. This detector is a high gain detector that has three different gains, as the AGIP detector that the European X-FEL. You can run it up to 1 kilohertz, and it could be that in the future this is also the type of detector you need for the diffraction limited radiation sources, where the single photon detector is at the end of the capabilities. Okay, I have just two slides on science, just because you know all that, and you certainly know that Jörg Stanfus has made a lot of experiments, time-resolved experiments. One of them was at the LCLS in December 2015. People in the audience help us also very much, or help them very much in getting that experiment done. The experiment was very successful. It's already published about the different retinal attachment sites and translocation pathway of retinal in bacterial rhodopsin. I don't need to explain that to you, but because you are the experts, from my point of view, the only thing I want to say is we have now for SwissFEL all the different pieces we need in order to do this type of experiments. We have the people, we have the detector, we know how to deal with the optical lasers, we know how to deal with the injector. We can synchronize the X-rays with the optical laser, and we know how to transport all the data from LCLS to PSI to make the evaluation at PSI. The full chain is already there before we have SwissFEL in place. And the other thing that we are doing, we are using also the same type of injector at the Swiss light source in order to make a comparison of structural determination either at FELS or at the SLS or even with cryo-EM in order to see what is the best strategy to follow for the different type of systems. Do you need the cryo, do you need the other, or at the end you need all of three? And that means we have the two chains, SwissFEL and SLS. Okay, just a few words on the next step. We said the continuation is just building up the second branch, the soft X-ray branch that is mostly dedicated to the light elements, just copper, nitrogen, oxygen, the water window of the magnetism, all the correlated electron system with the transition metals, mangan, iron, and copper, or even going to this aluminium, silicon, phosphor, and sulfur. Well, the scientific case is mostly dedicated now just to ultra-fast magnetization dynamics, catalysis and biochemistry on the surface, time-resolved correlated electron systems, and nonlinear X-ray optics. Here's always something missing about biology. We always have the discussions, what should we do in soft X-ray? That's something I will pass to you. I discuss always, can we use that with the single particle imaging as the soft X-ray part? But in our scientific case, biology is still not there. Now, the very good thing of this new layout is the following. In the old times, you just build undulators very long, something around 4 meters, with just some interconnection between them to have the phase of the electrons in the right position, and you just fill it from all the undulators you need. Now, Sven Reiche and the co-workers have had a new idea, and they are making the so-called distributing magnetic chicanes. They are separating the undulators in 2 meter spaces with a lot of distributing chicanes in the different parts. And the good thing is that you can work with these chicanes and use, with a very complicated idea, probably the accelerator people can explain much better to us, different parts of the electron beam to radiate. So that every time you are radiating, what the accelerator people means, with a fresh electron beam. And you have done a completely different way of doing things. And they have called this chicanes for high power and improved coherence. That means you can do with this type of new scheme, you can do a lot of different operation modes. First of all, the normal one, in case nothing happens, is just the sunset. But for me, the most important part is just on this lower part. You can have X-rays that are as short as 1 femtosecond, having 1 terawatt pulses. That's very nice. Or you can have a high brightness SASE, something with around 2 × 10⁻⁴ delta E over E. You don't need any monochromator at all. You can do 2 colors, changing the different distances. And you can have also a very large bandwidth also to do it. That means Atos is becoming now more a laser, not just a noise-producing such a machine. You have by far more flexibility, new ideas. And I would love that Sven Reiche would have this idea already 5 years ago. We would have built Aramis in a completely different way. That is probably one of the very good things in the future. All at 100 hertz, with the full control of the polarization. Okay. Schedule. The Atos branch will be built between 2017 and 2020. First experiments 2021. For the Aramis branch, the most important part, probably for you, we have started with the injector commissioning. We should have the first electron beam through all the accelerator from the beginning just to the dump by November this year. We have to do that because, the presidency of Switzerland is changing every year between the 7 different members of the government. And it happens to be that in this year, our direct boss, the responsible for Switzerland, is president also of the Confederation. And he asked in January, is there any chance that I can inaugurate Switzerland? And we said, of course. That means we are doing also that he can inaugurate Switzerland as a president of the Confederation in December of this year. That doesn't mean that we will have just the lace. We will have all the things prepared in order to lace. That will be probably in February, March next year. We should start the commissioning of the experimental stations at a lower energy. We don't have all the modulators installed to go up to 12 kV, but some between September, October next year, we should already start with experiments at 3.4 kV or even at the third harmonics, that's at 10 kV. We have ideas how to do that. We should start really the first experiments after the commissioning of the beam lines by November next year. And the full experiments with 12 kV beginning of next year, beginning of 2018. That means we are already thinking on the access of Swissfell. It's really as all the other synchrotron or free electron laser facilities in the world, completely open to the academic users through the normal peer review system. It's also open for industries with a proprietary set of full costs. What full costs means? Something around, we have heard, something around 2 million yen per 2 hours or 40,000 dollars per hour. We will somewhere in between. We don't know exactly, but it will be the case. And we think that probably something around 5 to 8% of the beam time could be dedicated to industrial applications. The beam time for users really through peer review will start March, April 2018. From end 2017 up to March 2018, we are just doing pilot experiments with some selected groups. I think in 2018, the ASA station, that is mostly important for biology applications, will deliver approximately in total 2,400 hours, 50% probably dedicated to SFX, 102,000 hours. We will install the peer review committee just by the end of this year, and we will have the first course of proposals August, September 2017 for the round starting March 2018. Okay, I'm just coming more or less to the end. Just two announcements we will have. We are organizing together with all the free electron lasers of Europe, the Science at Fels at Trieste. You are kindly invited to be there. And we are also organizing just an accelerator burst for nonlinear terahertz science at Swiss Fell in October 2013. Okay, just at the end, I really want to acknowledge a lot of people that had helped us to make the very nice measurements at LCLS with Jörg Stanfus, the big groups, and all the collaborating teams, especially people that are in the audience. Thank you very much for your collaboration.
Questions? A few slides back on the schedule slide, it had something called RF modulators. What was that?
That are the most important things. You see, the technical infrastructure is already finished, the machine is completely installed, the photonics installation is all there, but the modulators in order to feed up the power, they are coming late. That means we have all installed and the modulators are coming just somehow in behind. And you see the problem is that we will have the last modulator that we need in order to reach 6 GeV just at the first half of 2017. That means this, the production of the modulators is really on the critical path. And that's what determines the progress of the whole project. Has to do just with the video and one company that was not accepting our decisions, going to court and all these other things.
I usually read that, you know, the LCLS has 2.5 millijoules per pulse, right, X-ray energy. And then suddenly all these machines are 6 millijoules per pulse. You're going with 1 millijoule per pulse, as I see that roughly around that. Why is there no push for machines with, say, 10 millijoules per pulse?
Well, in principle, the European Israel would do it because they, in principle, what you have to do is you have to increase the first order, the current, not the 200 picocoulomb, but 1,000 picocoulomb. But that goes beyond all the technical capabilities we have. Probably the only one that will reach that level at the end is the European Israel. They have the 70.5 GeV,
they should have in principle the power to do that.
No, the question is, isn't there any scientific evidence to do that? For example, single particle imaging, that needs a lot of intensity, right? And lots of photons. And I think this is one of the most important scientific projects for the XFLs, right? And so I would imagine if you produce a machine for single particle imaging, it has to have as much as possible power. Right?
That's not the compact one.
But no, but my understanding, we saw in an earlier talk that the structure starts, the damage occurs in 20 femtoseconds.
So yes.
The power has to arrive. It doesn't help to make more power no longer pulse.
No. It has to be on the order of 10 terawatts having all the pulses within 10 femtoseconds. Yes. That's not easy. You see, we are arriving at the soft X-rays, this terahertz production because of the very short pulses in the soft X-ray panel. I don't know if we can reach that in there. But certainly, we are with this type of Swiss field at lower electron energy, we cannot put as our killer experiment the single particle imaging. We have to go to a completely other things, time resolved chemistry, condensed matter physics, nonlinear optics, where you can produce enough intensity to investigate all these things in the range that we can reach.
Will there be a single particle injector?
Not in the first phase. Not in the first phase, but we can think about it.
You asked, what's the use of soft X-rays for biology? This is a question which has puzzled people all around the world for about 10 years. We do have the zone plate X-ray microscope, I'm sure you know about,
yes.
The whole cell imaging. There's one at the ILS. It's worth remembering that the intensity of scattering goes, I think, as lambda squared, so you get far stronger scattering at lower energy. But I would ask Tom here, for solutions, they want an application to biology of soft X-ray. For solution scattering, there's a problem, isn't it, with background or something, where you get much more scattering. Why don't you work at 4 kV, 3 kV?
You could. Essentially, it just spreads out your diffraction pattern. It just depends on what the setup of the beam. I mean, you get lower energy, you get more power in principle, but a lot of beam lines just aren't set up to do that by conventional sign sources.
So they could do that. Now, is there more background in from the solute of the liquid and from the more absorption? That's what I thought was the problem, is the absorption, right? But the elastic scattering is much stronger. I mean, it's 10 times stronger when you go from 1 to 10 kV.
It's the absorption of the liquid also.
Right.
Whatever it's held in.
The courage, yeah. But so you're not better off with low.
It seems about us.
Or you mentioned Sven Reich's new idea for the Athos undulator, the short undulator section.
Yes.
Is that how it's actually being built?
We are building another prototype. And we should have finished this prototype in 6 months from now so that we can go into the full production. You see, by building short undulators, you need at the end the proportionality is the same, you need at least 20 units. Mm-hmm. Then it's a question not only how good can you build one unit, but how good can you build one unit at costs that are affordable. Mm-hmm. And every save in one unit is a save of factor of 20 in the whole undulator. That means we are now, you see, the engineers start with something that's great, and then you have to come to the bare minimum. We are in that process. I think we are very close to that.
It looks like it gives tremendous capabilities.
Oh yes, yes.
So let's just return to John's point about soft X-rays from microscopy. We now have the very coherent beam. The question is: are there ways to rethink how we're doing microscopy altogether, rather than something as 19th century as a zone plate?
Yes.
Well, just opening it for discussion. I mean, there's, well, it's the diffractive lens imaging, diffractive imaging, where you,
right.
And doing that in 3D.
But diffractive imaging is a low contrast method, okay? And it seems to me here that there are ways of using the coherence to develop high contrast from low dose of relative. So it's some kind of new phase contrast technology or.
Well, diffractive imaging is phase contrast. You just solve the phase problem digitally, except rather than use the zone plane. So there's no limit due to the wavelength due to aberrations.
Yeah, but I was talking about contrast between, say, a cell and the surrounding medium. Okay, it's the same problem as you have in solution scattering. It's fundamentally a low contrast scattering process when compared to the background.
Right. So people have tried to add heavy atoms to the host medium. You would know about this, and it wasn't very successful. I never fully understood why. But certainly, you can put a contrast medium in the host in the insects rather than in the sample. Works just as well. Do you know why that isn't commonly done? To get more contrast. You tune into the absorption of the host, like the Babinet principle.
That's all in the fact, I mean, it's.
But certainly, what atoms will be used very much in the holographic methods in order to see magnetic order in materials, where you have just either a hole and the beam and you are making just holography. Or you can put a reference marker in between and you have the holography. These ideas are very well developed for magnetic materials. Why not extend that? There are probably other problems, but.
Well, the problem is that if you go, so we have the single particle work that you've said, I think wisely, is not your first priority initially anyway. If you then go to something larger, the problem is that, as Moffat says, heterogeneity increases with size in nature. That's the heart of the problem. If you go to whole cells, they're all different, so you can't merge the data to make 3D interactive imaging. You're just stuck with 2D projections. And then it's worse than that. When you go to high resolution, you have to deal with the curvature of the Ebert sphere, so they're not even projections. Those are the hard problems. So I thought solution scattering was the best use of softer X-rays because you get stronger scattering, but as Ed points out, there's an absorption problem.
More questions?
Okay, we're still thinking.
Yeah, we spent this.
Okay, thank you very much.